like to introduce this morning's speaker.
And he is Marc Greenberg. Some of you know him already. He's been here before. He is the executive director of the Interfaith Assembly on Homelessness and Affordable Housing. And he has just as much, if not more, going on this weekend as I do. Because he's a very, very busy man. And he's brought one of his graduates, Augustine's son is Justin, who will be talking to us about the life skills program that they offer. So welcome back, Marc Greenberg.
Thank you, Ann. I just want to say it is always such a joy to be here today, particularly with this family naming baby. What a joy, really. And as Ann mentioned, I brought one of our graduates, Augustine, and his son, Justin, who may be having a better time in the other room, so I'm not sure if you'll be joining us, but I'm just so pleased that we were able to bring our family here as well as we celebrated your family. So for those of you that may not have heard my story before, I'm going to start by talking a little bit about something that happened about 25 years ago. Well, the Interfaith Assembly was founded actually in around 1985 at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine as a result of a number of conversations that we had. And the beginning of the conversation was that a woman came to the cathedral who had been Woman of the Year under Mayor Lindsay, a woman by the name of Lillian Zerwick. She was Woman of the Year because she had decided that it would make sense to provide services in the places where poor people were living. And so she really established the idea of supportive housing. And Mayor Lindsay recognized that. And she came to the cathedral. She had been retired a number of years. She said, housing should be a legal entitlement, just like food. And if the cathedral and the religious community is willing to work for this, I'll be a full-time volunteer. So Jim Morton, who was the dean at the time, called me in and said, what do you think about this? And we went and met with elected officials and religious leaders and advocates, and we said, does this make sense for housing to be a legal right? They said, yes. They said, you'll never get there, but that's the direction you need to go. We need to declare that, that in a civilized society, everyone needs a place to live. And that's how we started. And so we would then advocate for policies that would bring that about. And the way we began to do that was to bear witness at places where homelessness was visible. So we'd go to soup kitchens and shelters and drop-in centers and SROs, and we'd say, is this what we're being called to do as a society? Can't we do better than this? And then one day, some of you may have been around, the New York City Council was about to pass a law that would require that if any landlord would convert SRO housing, which was the housing of last resort, to luxury housing, he or she would have to contribute $45,000 to a fund, the low-income housing fund. And a miracle of miracles, the night before the law was about to pass, two buildings mysteriously blew up in the middle of Midtown, owned by Harry Macklow, a gas leak. And so the next day we were there saying, is this what we're being called to do? Now, it turned out that that law, though it passed and it would have been retroactive, was overturned by the state Supreme Court. It's called an unfair taking of property without just compensation. However, the fact is that we know that we've lost 200,000 units of SRO housing. We've lost 350,000 units of regulated housing. There's a lot that has happened to make the problem worse. And just to step back, for those people who may not know, up to 1980, 70% of all the dollars that were spent on low-income housing, on affordable housing, were federal dollars as a result of the National Affordable Housing Act of 1939, I think it was. 1980, Ronald Reagan said, homelessness is not a national problem. Cities and states can take care of it. And since that time, almost immediately, the federal housing support dropped by two-thirds. Around the same time, it was ruled that people couldn't be held mentally ill. People could not be held against their will unless they were of imminent danger to themselves or others. And so mental health institutions closed. The second part of the plan was we were supposed to create community residences. That never happened. So combined, the drop in federal support, the release of mental institutions and no replacement, the loss of SRO housing, the loss of rental housing, and frankly, policies for the last 30 years that have been regressive and punitive. Up to about 6 months ago, the number was going up and was up to 60,000, highest in history. Now this new mayor came with a vision and began to implement it, and as a result, the number is finally, for the first time in about 12 years, started to go down. Now, we all know that it's a big problem, and there are many things that need to be done, and he's having some real challenges implementing some of his policies, and he's got a big resistance from our friend up in Albany. Any news that you read, you can see that the governor is doing his best to make sure that the mayor is not successful in almost anything he attempts. But despite that, my sense is, and I think my colleagues feel, that this mayor is saying the right things and trying to do the right things. As a matter of fact, when de Blasio was public advocate, Bloomberg and Cuomo decided to stop a rental subsidy program that had been founded by both of them. And then the governor said, I'm not going to support this anymore. And the mayor said, well, if you're not going to, I'm not going to. And so the mayor's administration stopped giving new vouchers, but there were at that point 17,000 families getting these vouchers. And with legal aid, we fought the city to continue to provide subsidies to the people who had the vouchers, which were a 1 year or 2 year voucher. And de Blasio was fighting very hard on the same side. So when the mayor came into office, everyone knew that he wanted to reestablish this rental subsidy. But when he went to Albany and said, can you change one sentence in the budget to allow the use of federal funds? The governor said, well, you're not giving me any notice. This is very short. He was doing it for 2 years. He was fighting the subsidy for 2 years. So anyway, that's enough about their relationship. But clearly the mayor is having some challenges in doing what needs to be done. But let me step back a little bit and give you a little history of how we got to where we are. So we were bearing witness, going to events, going to places to basically ask, is this what we want to do as a society? And we decided that we would then bear witness at City Hall when the budget was being finalized. So in 1985, we began to have an overnight vigil in City Hall Park. And we did that in 85 and 86 and 87. And in 88, what happened was we started with a service at St. Paul's Chapel, 400 people marching to the park with 120 people ready to spend the night. We had this torrential rainstorm. And in the morning, there were 12 of us left. And of the 12, six of us were homeless. They helped us to survive, some of them veterans. We went and got wood and stayed warm and made shelters out of the benches, which at that time you could lift up and move. Now they're bolted down. And we had arranged for a meeting with the most progressive members of City Council, with Ruth Messenger and Miriam Friedlander and great man. And what they said to us was, these are the issues you should be looking at, but what they said to the folks who were with us who were homeless was, you know, we're here because we're the members, Stan Michaels, we're here because we're the members of City Council that care about homelessness. You need to be talking to people who didn't come to this meeting. And so the folks who were with us who were homeless said, well, we want to go back into the park. We want to meet the other council members. And we said, but that could be a month outside on the street in the park. And they said, look, we were just told, many of us already live on the street. We were just told we could make a difference. And a light went off. And we realized that these folks wanted to change their lives and change the lives for others. They wanted to be of value. We all need to be of value. This is very early for me in this work, and I started to understand who we were advocating for, and they ended up having a presence in City Hall Park from June 1st to Christmas Day, 200 days in the park. And in this process, we got to know them, and we thought, well, we could be more effective advocating if people who were homeless could share their own story. So it's not just numbers, but it's people, it's lives. And we initially decided we would help them to tell their story, start developing a training, and then we quickly realized, well, they're sharing the story and will help us advocate, but it's not going to help them. They're not homeless because they're not good public speakers. They're homeless because something terrible has happened in their lives. Because they were left at the point where there was no option but the street or the shelters. We can understand you only become homeless after everything else fails. You can't stay with friends or family, you lose your job, you're injured. That's the lowest point in their lives. And it's not going to help them if they can be good public speakers and help us advocate. So what we did was we took our intent to help develop a speaker's training and turned it into what is now what we call a life skills empowerment program. We developed it with Catholic Charities in 1989. Since then, we've helped, there have been 9 other programs established. The Assembly helped establish 5 of them, and people at Fordham University, a group called the Beck Institute, about 6 years ago, adopted our work, started doing evaluations, started doing training manuals. They've established another 6. So now, another 5. So now 10, working with domestic violence survivors, with ex-offenders, with homeless youth, with homeless veterans, and with homeless adults. And it's been a very exciting process. And my friend will share some of his story, because he recently graduated from our program, which is based at West End Presbyterian on 105th Street. And that's a program that Ann and I have been talking about. We'd love to invite some of you to help support. And you will be very inspired by my friend. I've been very inspired. So half of the work became working with folks and helping them to heal and asking them to be part of our community. As I said, since we started, over 1,200 people have graduated. Many of them are now in social services. I mean, they're helping provide social services to others. Very impressive folks. But the other half of our work, as I said, is advocacy, and we've continued to advocate. And so we have played a role through the years in various campaigns. And the way we view policy is when you think about homelessness and how do you kind of get at it, it's massive, it's very complicated. So we created this kind of virtual house with 4 walls as a way of envisioning the issue. So imagine a house with 4 walls, one being producing affordable housing, the second being preventing homelessness, the third being providing services, and the fourth being promoting income. So our advocacy is kind of opportunistic. Where can a difference be made? And what we do is we try to bring the faith community into line with the advocates. Because in many cases, as we know, we speak about values. And this is an issue of values. It's not an issue of budgets and legislation. It's an issue of values, an issue of vision. And we need to have a vision of a society where everybody has a place to live and everyone has a place. That's our vision. And if we can promote that vision and say this can be done, then it will be done. If we don't think it can be done, then what's the point? There's always going to be homeless people, so we'll help them a little bit. But we have to have a vision of a city, and I think, frankly, our mayor does, that everyone has a place. And we can afford to provide housing, to provide people an opportunity for housing. So now, at this moment, there are 2 focuses of our advocacy. Let me say one focus, not of the 2, but a third, which is an ongoing, is that, as you probably know, the mayor has committed to the production and preservation of 200,000 units of housing over the next 10 years. And he's doing it in a very creative way. He's now established that any new housing development in the city will include affordable housing through something called inclusionary zoning. And this is unheard of. Under Bloomberg, we had inclusionary zoning as part of some initiatives, but it was not mandatory. The commissioner then, Sean Donovan, who then went on to be the federal head of housing, said, we're going to provide the developers with such a good deal that they can't say no. But it's not, so he said, we'll guarantee it, but it's not going to be mandatory. As it turned out, and Brad Lander, who's now a prominent member of the city council, was part of this conversation and said, he said, it needs to be mandatory. And it turns out that many of these guarantees have not come to pass, that there are always ways, there's some, you know, loopholes and some fine print, and we haven't gotten the affordable housing that was supposed to be part of these agreements. So now, any new development includes affordable housing, which is a terrific idea. Now, we'd like more of the units could be affordable to the very low income, because the hardest people to house are the working poor, which means we need more what we call socially owned housing, like public housing or housing owned by nonprofits. And we're getting there. But I think the point is that we need to push the mayor as an ally and not as an enemy. He's trying to do the best thing, and he's getting pushed back from neighborhoods who are saying, we don't want bigger buildings, we don't want poor people. We need to stand up and say, this is what is right, this is what is just, and let's find a way to make it happen. So that's one ongoing focus for us. But the two others that I want to mention, and I'd like your help on, one deals with the fact that every year, about 30,000 households face eviction in housing court. In fact, when we questioned people in the shelter, the last event that occurred before homelessness was an eviction. Now, that's a terrible tragedy, but even worse is the fact that about 15,000 of those households would not have been evicted if they had legal counsel. They knew their rights, and they knew what resources were available, they would still be in their homes. I mean, that's terrible. And further, studies show that for every dollar we spend on legal counsel for low-income people, we save six public dollars. So it's a very, very wise investment. Now, recently, the city established the Office of Social... Let me just back up a little bit so that we understand the law. We all have seen Law and Order. Well, you know, your right to counsel if you don't have one will be provided. That's in criminal court, not in civil court. No right to counsel in the civil court. You can be evicted, you don't have a right to counsel. You jump a turnstile, you have a right to counsel. Something's wrong with this picture. But the first step that has been taken is we have established the Office of Civil Justice in New York City, which means that this is the place where people who are being evicted or people who are dealing with immigration issues or other civil issues can go and ask for help. At this point, not enough free counsel available to them. In fact, one attorney who's been working on this right to counsel case said that attorneys who are providing help to the poor in housing court spend most of the day trying to decide who they can help and who they can't help. And it's a horrible thing to say, you're not needy enough, you're going to be evicted tomorrow, I'm going to help you. So we've established the Office of Civil Justice. Now we have to make sure that the funds are there to provide legal counsel. And let me say, this is not something that can happen overnight. To increase the capacity of our society to provide enough counsel to all low-income people facing eviction will take time. And we are confident that Steve Banks, who is now heading HRA, which is where the Office of Civil Counsel is located, is moving in that direction. We need to encourage him, and we need to encourage us as a society to say, this is what we must do. This is what we must put our resources. Just again, for those of you who don't know, Steve Banks was appointed head of HRA, which is responsible to care for the city's poor. For 30 years, Steve was the lead attorney suing the city to provide rights to the homeless. So you could not find a better person than Steve Banks to be in that position. And so we're incredibly pleased that he's there. So that's one issue. And there will be an event, I think, in early December. We don't even have a date on the right to counsel. But the other issue is more long-term, and we now see more and more people on the street, singles. The number of single homeless people has gone up. The number of families has started to go down. But the number of singles has started to increase again. And a significant portion of them are mentally ill or physically disabled. So I mentioned supportive housing. There are now about 36,000 units of supportive housing in New York. This is housing with services. Housing that where services are offered and provided, but not imposed, but people can get the services if they need them, and there is casework. New York City and New York State have, since 1980, entered into three agreements called New York-New York agreements between New York City and New York State, and together they've provided 16,000 of these units, very successfully. The first of them was the St. Francis Friends of the Poor, which is for mentally frail mentally ill adults run by the Franciscans. But now the fact is that of the 20,000 people who are deemed eligible every year for supportive housing, only 1 out of 6 get the housing because there's not enough housing. So we now have this New York 4 campaign, which is a call to the governor and the mayor to commit to 35,000 units of supportive housing over the next 10 years. It's a heavy lift, but there's a need. And for every person in supportive housing, we save thousands of dollars a year because they're not in shelters, they're not in hospitals, they're not in prison. And obviously the humane thing to do. So we have what we hope will be a very well-attended rally right here. Thank you, Anne, for agreeing to co-sponsor. It'll be downstairs in Assembly Hall. And we have some flyers in the back, and we'd like each of you to consider joining us for that. In addition, we have been gathering names of faith leaders. We now have over 230 faith leaders who signed onto a letter, including Anne. And we have about 900 letters from individual members of communities. Those letters are out there. We'd like you to each sign them so we can add your name. And we hope and we think that we're making some progress. In addition, let me say that 133 of the 150 state assembly members have signed a letter to the governor. There are over 310 organizations who've signed on to the campaign. And now, and this is very exciting, we're beginning to have a conversation with the state senate. The Republicans in the state senate, there's great interest. And we hope that at our event, if not before, there'll be an announcement that the state senate is signing on or endorsing this. So the governor will have no place to hide. Right. It's something that has to be done. If everyone's calling for it, even if the mayor is also for it, that shouldn't be enough of a reason not to do it. Let's hope we can provide such a groundswell that the governor thinks he can be a hero on this as well. So, and I think, you know, here's something that will help people for generations to come. And it's so important that we do everything we can to make it happen. So I really ask for your help to join us, to get the word out. Let's try to fill up the whole 700 people. Would be wonderful. If we have 500, we'd be very happy. There'll also be elected officials there. There'll be folks there who are in supportive housing. There'll be people there who are eligible but haven't yet gotten supportive housing. And there'll be a kind of roundtable discussion at the end, a strategy session. It should be a very good, very exciting event. And, of course, we welcome you. So, now I want to just say a little bit more about Augustine and about the program. So this life skills program that is called Panim El Panim, which means face-to-face in Hebrew, is supported by a network of faith communities, of synagogues and churches. And, I don't know if Ethical Culture is formally signed on, but we hope that you'll be able to help in helping make this program work. And so, just in a nutshell, it's a 3-month program. We meet twice a week. We have dinner twice a week. 3 different kinds of sessions. One of them, people work with mentors to help them work on their goals. Another type of sessions, people learn to share their story with each other. And then we bring, a third type of session, we bring people in to share a conversation on a topic of importance, on ethics, for example, or values. So there's an opportunity for us to be visited by, to have Anne lead that. And so what I'd like to ask each of you to consider as a community is there a role that you might want to play? Could you be a mentor and work with someone one-on-one 7 times over a 3-month period, help them articulate and begin to move towards achieving their goals? Could you, as a community or as a family, provide a meal for 10, 12 people? If it's a mentor night, it could be 20 people. And join us for the meal and get to know some of the folks. Or could you sponsor a participant? We provide a stipend. We provide $5 for every session they attend for transportation. And then when they graduate, they get another $10 for every session they attend. So they could get as much as $350 or $400 when they graduate, which certainly is helpful for folks who don't have a lot of extra money. So those are ways that you can help. And to understand how the program helps our brothers and sisters, I want to invite Augustine to come up and share a little bit of his story.
into the microphone.
We want to hear you.
Hey.
Sorry about that. How you guys doing? My name's Augusto. My name's Augusto Ayala, and I participate in Panim Opening. It's a great program, and I'm not saying it just to say it. I'm going to give you a brief understanding of the type of person I am, But I'm an ex-criminal. I dedicated about half of my life to committing crimes, all right? I grew up in the projects, very violent environment, and, you know, it led me to make bad choices in life, okay? Before that, you know, I got punished. I had to go to prison quite a few times. My last time I went to prison, I did 9 years. I just came home from doing 9 years. In that time, I learned that I had a child, but apparently the mother didn't tell me. So I learned about him about when he was 6.5 years old. Did DNA, found out he was mine. So from prison, you can actually fight for custody of your child. Just because you're incarcerated doesn't give up your rights, all right? So I was fighting for about 2 years for custody while in prison. When I came home, I won custody. Got custody of my child. He's somewhere downstairs with the other kids. But I did get custody of my child, and that's what made me change my life. Because he needed me, because his mother abandoned him when he was born. So, that being said, while I was in prison, I just felt like I have to do this. You know, there's no way around this. There's, you know, my ex-life was over with. And mind you, those 6.5 years before I found out about him, all I was planning was, how was I going to get back on top? All right? Because that's all I did all my life. But when he came into my life, all those 6 years just went right out the door. And I had to make everything work for him. So today I'm here because of him. Because everything I do in life right now revolves around my son. That being said, once I got custody of him, we went in a shelter. We're still in a shelter. It was difficult for me to obtain employment, of course, because of my criminal history and background. So I bumped into one of the facilitators for Panim Opening at a church. We were having lunch, and they offered me to come in. So I, you know, waited out of there. Why not? You know, it's not too far from the shelter where I'm at. So I went, started going, and I bumped into a lot of people that were also homeless, had their stories to share. And so to be sure, you know, from the life I used to live, I pretty much don't trust nobody. I don't, because in that type of environment, you can't trust nobody. So I pretty much didn't trust these guys at all. I thought it was all a scam. But at the end of the day, they proved me wrong. And they actually helped me out. They kept me strong, kept me focused on the road to eventually a job and hopefully soon somewhere to live. But they have the right idea. They just need some help. They really do. They got the right idea. They got the good staff. And they actually do help, as opposed to other programs there are in the city that say they help, but they really don't. They just pocket the money at the end of the day. Which is true. You know, I'm pretty sure you guys have heard. But this program did help me a lot, and it kept me on track. Between them and my son, it was a beautiful thing. You know, right now, I just recently found a job. I work for a facilities unit for the controller's office. So that's good. It's part time, but hey, I'm gonna get the full time. That being said, you know, if anything you guys can do to help a program such as Panim Opening, trust me, your time, your money, your whatever you can do for them will be gratefully appreciated and is needed. And it's going to be put to use in the right ways, not the wrong ways. These guys. know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. They're going for the right way, and I love them. And to this day, I'm in contact with them. So, as you can see, I'm here speaking, and I'm willing to speak in any other events that they need me to, because I'm grateful for what they did for me on my side. There were times I had a part-time job last year with Uncommon Goods, and I would come out late, and my son would go from after school straight to the program, and they would take care of him and feed him until I got there, which was a wonderful thing, because I would trust nobody with my son. But they were there to help. And between all the participants and the staff, they would feed him, help him, talk to him, make sure he was okay until I got there. And he loves him. To this day, I bump into some of the participants, which are still homeless, unfortunately. But we bump into each other. And the first thing they ask for is, where's your son? You know, he touches everybody. I don't know why. But that being said, you guys look like a smart group. So. Please do whatever you can to help the program to keep in existence, because they really do need the help, you know. And thanks, Mark, and thank you guys for listening.
There are sheets in the back if you want to give us your name so you can get our newsletters. If you want to volunteer, there's an opportunity to do that. And there's a letter to sign that we will present to the mayor and the governor. So please, before you leave, make sure to give us your name and tell us how you'd like to help. Thank you.
Thank you.